The resultant maps, made at the National Research Council in the scale of 1 to 50,000, are the basis on which the findings of the expedition are plotted. Changes can be shown, such as the formation of a lake known as Phantom Lake, where meltwaters are dammed up by the Thompson Glacier. It is possible to record the size of a nunatak, Eskimo name for a piece of land surrounded by ice. Future mapping will show whether it has grown or shrunk. The maps show such phenomena as the advancing snout of the Thompson Glacier with the push moraine in front of it. It was originally thought that the polar glaciers were receding, but it has been discovered that some are advancing. The Thompson Glacier is advancing at the rate of 25 meters per year and pushing up in front of it a complex of frozen sand and gravel. This 100-foot ice cliff is the snout of Thompson Glacier. The foliation, or layering of the ice, results from accumulated pressures and stresses which induce crystal changes as the ice moves down the valley. The sweeping folds and disrupting faults show that ice can behave in both a plastic and a rigid manner. The clear ice on top overrides the fallen dirt-covered lumps at the foot of the cliff. The structures in this massive wall depict the final chapters in the history of the glacier. The new moraine is young in terms of Earth, still unsettled because of dead ice melting underneath. The appearance of lichen gives information about the age of the moraine. The size of this fast-growing lichen shows that the rock to which it clings has been at rest for at least 100 years. This lichen grows about 2 inches in a century. Here is the growth of 150 years. The witch's ring grows slowly outward, its living edges black, its dying center, white. To measure the rates of lichen growth on Axel Heiberg Island, botanist Dr. Roland Beschel takes photographs for comparison with future pictures. In pockets of till between the rocks, pioneer plants appear. Stellaria, Arctic poppy, and purple saxifrage. The diameter of these plant cushions is a measure of their age. Well beyond the moraine, in protected areas where moisture is available, a rich accumulation of vegetation builds up peat deposits. Tall cotton grasses and sedges grow on such enriched soil. Careful study of these plants will facilitate the recognition of their remains and their pollens in the peat deposits. About 1 kilometer from the snout of the Thompson Glacier, at an elevation of only some 8 meters above sea level, a peat profile 3 meters deep has been exposed by erosive action of the Expedition River. The deepest peat deposit measured before in the high Arctic was less than 1/2 meter. The peat consists mostly of decayed mosses. Carbon-14 dating of the bottom layers gives an age of about 4,200 years. Absence of both glacial and marine deposits shows that the Thompson Glacier has not gone beyond this point, nor has the sea been higher for 40 centuries. Where there is plant life, there are animals and birds, like the curious ptarmigan and the muskox, a species able to live by digging for fodder through the shallow snow. Originating in Eurasia in pre-glacial times, the muskox survived the ice ages and is now found only in the Canadian High Arctic and in Greenland. Below the moraine, the Expedition River flows into the fjord, cutting braided channels in the gravel. Geomorphologist Dr. Benoit Robitaille and Claude Greffard study shells from coastal beaches. Carbon-14 dating of the shells will show when these beaches rose from the polar sea. Where shells are lacking, pebbles studied for wind and wave erosion indicate age and whether the beach is of marine or glacial lake formation. When the ice receded some 10,000 years ago, the land began to rise. Successive sea levels washed new ridges in the gravel beaches, and such strand lines tell the history of the last 100 centuries. The oldest earth science, geology, looks still farther into prehistory. The island is mainly sedimentary rock, laid down by seas that covered this part of the earth hundreds of millions of years ago, and later, wildly disturbed by tectonic upheavals. Dr. Peter Fricker studies the abundant fossils from which he can establish the chronological sequence of the strata and compile a detailed map which will set the expedition findings against the broad perspective of geological time. The process of change continues. The lighter, softer gypsum squeezes up, slowly piercing the overlying sediments, casting up ridges and domes. The brittle black basalt, with layer upon upturned layer forming sharply eroded cliffs, adds drama to the crest of the mountains and indicates volcanic disturbance in the remote past. Little by little, the integrated findings of the scientists become more meaningful. Under the leadership of Dr. Mueller, Dr. George Jacobson, who initiated the expedition, and Dr. Cyril James, Principal Emeritus of McGill, who recognized the value of extending the function of the university beyond the libraries and laboratories of Montreal. The value of scientific research should be judged not by the improvement it allows in our way of life, for who will be the arbiter of what is an improvement, but by the contribution it makes towards man's knowledge. Nansen, the great Arctic explorer, wrote in his book, Farthest North, "The spirit of mankind will never rest till every spot of these regions has been trodden by the foot of man. Till every enigma has been solved." We may have reached the end of geographical discovery, but there is no end to the discovery of the laws of nature. With the conclusion of the fourth summer in the field, the expedition will not have finished its work. The full meaning of its findings will be clear only after years of analysis and writing up of reports and scientific papers. From this platform of well-documented knowledge, a new generation of explorers will set out to find new land in the realm of man's understanding of the unknown.